Harper One and Harper Audio present Driving the Green Book, a road trip through the living history of Black resistance by Alvin Hall with Carl Weber. This is Alvin Hall. A note before we begin. For notes on the text, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/drivingthegreenbook. To the generous people who, over the course of my Green Book journeys, shared their experiences, memories, and truth to make all of us wiser, stronger, and kinder. And to J. Stephen Shepherd, my lawyer, agent, and friend, who never wavered in his passionate support of every phase of my Green Book journeys, the road trips, the podcasts, and this book. That Black people have had to create mechanisms for survival is an indictment of America. But it is also a testament to people of color that we have found ways to cope and survive and navigate this incredibly unfair and complex world. The Green Book and a lot of other things like it were the tools that people used to navigate. Brian Stevenson, lawyer and founder of the Equal Justice Initiative. Things like the Green Book tell us there's somebody in my corner, somebody who wants to make sure I safely get to my destination. I think that's a metaphor for life. We want to help people safely through life. T. Marie King, community organizer, facilitator, and trainer in Birmingham, Alabama. Introduction. You would think that my journey with the Negro Motorist Green Book would have begun in an automobile. In fact, it began in a plane. The year was 2015. I was flying to London and, as I often do, had brought along a stack of magazines to pass the time. One article about road trips around the U.S. referred in passing to the Negro Motorist Green Book. As far as I remember, it probably mentioned that the travel guide had been used by Black travelers during segregation, but I don't recall the word segregation itself being used. My interest was immediately piqued. I had never heard of the publication. That's not surprising considering that I grew up in the 1950s and 1960s, dirt poor, living on land my family owns in the rural Florida panhandle. The phrase dirt poor means we possessed only that parcel of land that we lived on, growing and raising most of what we ate. Most Black people in the area lived along sandy, unpaved roads that wove through scrub pine forests with a few live oak trees draped with hanging moss. Lots of raccoons, opossum, squirrels, snakes, birds, and insects lived in the underbrush. The landscape was not verdant. It always looked slightly dry. But it was always humid because the area was near the Gulf of Mexico. We did not own a car. We could not afford one. We never traveled for vacations or other leisure activities. We only traveled to visit relatives, usually being driven by a family friend who owned a car, to places we could reach between sunrise and sunset. No one I knew drove overnight. So my family would have had no need for the Negro Motorist Green Book. Nonetheless, the publication's name and the article's brief description captured my imagination. I resolved to find out more. Back in New York after my work in London, I began my search by going to the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture. Located in Harlem and part of the New York Public Library, the Schomburg, as it is widely known, is America's premier archive for African American history. It contains a remarkable and growing trove of documents and artifacts about crucial, often little-known or overlooked histories, facts, and stories about Black Americans and their lives. Important for my purpose, and unlike any other archive I know, its collection of the publication I was looking for is almost complete. It lacks only one of the editions of the Green Book, which was published annually, except when publication was temporarily suspended during World War II, from 1936 to 1967. There, while I sat in a conference room in the rare books section, Associate Chief Librarian Myra Liriano brought me copies that I could hold in my hands and examine at leisure. This is no longer possible. The paper they were printed on has become too fragile. What I saw and read were listings of largely Black-owned enterprises, businesses that welcomed Black travelers in city after city and town after town across the U.S. I was amazed. Tallahassee, Florida, the nearest large city to where I grew up, was one of the first places I checked. Much to my surprise, I saw a listing for a lodging that I had never heard of, the Abner, Virginia Motel, on a street I knew well, Railroad Avenue. My relatives and I must have gone by it many times when going to Tallahassee to buy groceries or to see a doctor. But, not knowing its significance, I never paid any attention to the place. As I turned the pages of the Green Book, perusing listings in other cities where I had lived or visited, scanning articles featuring major U.S. vacation destinations, reading tips about how to prepare your car for a trip, and even advice about how to dress to project a respectable image while driving your car, one question echoed repeatedly through my mind. Why had I never heard of this publication? Then, just as I was beginning my research at the Schomburg in late 2015, I got an email from Jeremy Grange, a producer of radio programs at BBC Wales. In what seems a striking coincidence, he asked whether I would be interested in working with him as a presenter, called Host in America, on a documentary about the Negro Motorist Green Book for BBC Radio 4. Without hesitation, I said yes. At the time, almost none of my friends in New York and other U.S. cities had heard of the publication. The fact that Jeremy, a BBC producer living and working in Wales and not in the U.S., had also come across a mention of the Green Book in an article and thought it would serve as the basis for an interesting, informative documentary, made this opportunity feel profoundly fated. A quotation by James Baldwin kept coming to mind. A journey is called that because you cannot know what you will discover on that journey, what you will do with what you find, or what you find will do to you. I can't tell you the number of times I thought about these wise words and how prescient they proved to be in the journey ahead. I could not have known then that my exploration of the Negro Motorist Green Book would include two road trips. The first one, 5 days in the spring of 2015, started in Tallahassee, Florida, and ended in Ferguson, Missouri. Organized by Jeremy Grange, its purpose was to produce the 38-minute radio documentary. He and I conceived of the program as traveling not just through space, but through time as well, my lifetime. From where I grew up in the Jim Crow South, where laws severely limited the rights of Black people, as well as the social interaction between Black and white people, to the momentous contemporary events at the time in Ferguson. Jeremy, photographer Jonathan Calm, and I followed part of what is called the United States Civil Rights Trail, which links those cities, primarily in the South, in which African-American activists and supporters from all ethnic, religious, and racial backgrounds marched, protested, and endured personal danger, sometimes death, during the 1950s and 60s to fight for the right to vote, for racial equality, for social reform, and for fair legal treatment in all parts of life in the United States. We stopped in Birmingham and Selma, Alabama, Jackson, Mississippi, Memphis, Tennessee, and finally, Ferguson, Missouri. We visited the locations of once fancy and well-known hotels, tourist homes, restaurants, eateries, movie houses, and nightclubs that had been listed in the Green Book. We sought out and talked to people who generously recounted their stories of driving in the United States during the time when this guide and others like it were not just conveniences, but life-saving travel necessities. Our documentary, simply titled The Green Book, aired on BBC Radio 4 in November 2016. The second road trip, 12 days in June 2019, started in Detroit, Michigan, and ended in New Orleans, Louisiana. Its purpose was to create my 10-episode podcast series, Driving the Green Book, and was largely organized by field producer Oluwakemi Aladusuyi. This trip was inspired in part by an exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City in 2015 called One Way Ticket, Jacob Lawrence's Migration Series and Other Visions of the Great Movement North. Lawrence's ambitious, deeply affecting series consists of 60 tempera on panel paintings. Collectively, they vividly capture the shared hardships and disappointments African Americans experienced during the Great Migration, the period between 1910 and 1970 when more than 6 million Black people left the rural South and moved north and west for better opportunities. Terrorism sparked that transit, especially the drowning, burning, and lynching of Black men, women, and even families in the South. But the travelers also headed north in pursuit of better lives in new, growing industries, such as automobile manufacturing. The Great Migration remains the largest demographic shift in U.S. history. The introduction to the One Way Ticket exhibition featured a fascinating infographic showing how significantly the African-American population had increased in seven northern cities: Chicago, Cleveland, Detroit, New York, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, and St. Louis. The largest increase in those seven cities was in Detroit, whose African-American population increased from 1.2% in 1910 to 43.7% in 1970. The auto industry served as a magnet for residents from Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, Tennessee, the Florida Panhandle, and Louisiana. But despite their settling in Detroit, they left part of their hearts back home. Many of these people would want and need to return to the South to visit relatives. And their relatives in the South would travel north to visit them to see their new lives. This is why publications like The Green Book were crucial at that moment in history. Black travelers needed to know where it was safe to stop for even the most essential services, such as buying gasoline. So, associate producer Janae Woods Weber and I, accompanied by field producer Kemi Aladusuyi, took a more than 2,000-mile road trip from Detroit to New Orleans, with side trips to cities and towns along the way that would have been destinations for many travelers from the Motor City. Our goal on this trip, as it had been on the first, was to find people along the route who had used or heard of the Green Book and who patronize or knew of the locations, establishments, and businesses listed in the travel guide. We wanted a direct link to that history. The release of the movie Green Book in September 2018 unexpectedly increased my motivation and strengthened my resolve. I attended a screening of it in New York that was followed by a moderated talk with the director, producers, and principal actors. The moderator asked each a simple question. Had you heard of the Green Book before doing the movie? All said no. I was surprised, although I probably should not have been. Although the movie is called Green Book, it is decidedly not about...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.